So thanks all of you for coming down. It's really good to see you here. I'm really excited to hear what Steve has to say, actually. So we're all here to talk about free trade in particular. And as many of you all know, if you're economists or if you're familiar with economics, the case presented for free trade is usually pretty much the same in pretty much all contexts. Something along the lines of comparative advantage, the idea that no matter the state of the technology in either country, two countries can always get some kind of mutual benefit by working together and trading freely. But of course, in reality, this receives all kinds of challenges. It's received challenges from within the subject, the idea that if a country concedes to its comparative advantage, that may stop it developing its technology, it may stop it then accessing higher technology industries down the line. It should see challenges from outside the subject. Challenges along the lines that it may steal jobs. So this is what we've heard recently, particularly with the rise of the Trump administration, the idea that jobs leave rich countries and go to poor countries. We've heard an almost reverse argument, the argument that even though these jobs are moving, this is actually exploitative, that the only reason this comparative advantage exists is because it's exploiting cheap labour. And all of these criticisms, well, for many people, they seem to bounce off the economic profession. They just go with their models and say, this is a technical result, and people should really believe in free trade anyway. But of course, those who really argue free trade, those who argue with politicians and argue in the media, know that if you're going to present the case for free trade, it has to be made properly, it has to take account of the history and the politics, and it has to be a fully rounded argument. And that's why I'm really excited to invite Steve to come. He is the head of education at the Institute of Economic Affairs, one of the world's foremost free market think tanks. He has been the program officer at the Institute for Humane Studies at George Mason University in Virginia. And he's also been senior lecturer in history and economic history at Manchester Met. He's a really interesting speaker and really makes the case for the free market and the free trade sort of line very, very convincingly. And yeah, in a much more insightful way than many other people within economics. So I'm really excited to hear what he's got to say. I'm going to talk for around about half an hour, maybe more, and then we can open up some discussions and questions.
Thanks very much, Jacob. Well, actually, Jacob's introductory remarks set the scene for what I'm going to say perfectly, because the sort of starting point for my remarks tonight is that this is one of those areas where pretty much all economists, with a few striking exceptions on one side, and much of the public and a whole bunch of other people is on the other side. And there are many economists, including quite a few who I know, who spend a lot of their time scratching their heads or banging their heads against the metaphorical brick wall, trying to work out why the rest of the world doesn't see something that strikes them as being patently obvious and commonsensical. And I understand you were going to originally think of having a second speaker. What I'm going to do is not give you the kind of straightforward, well, here's the David Ricardo case for free trade, and this is what it actually means stuff that you'll commonly get from most economists. I'm going to actually take a slightly different tack, and hopefully what I will sort of like be able to show is that there is indeed, the economists are indeed right, there is indeed a general theoretical and practical case for having free exchange and trade, but that in addition, this comes with a whole series of trade-offs, and these trade-offs are often, in certain contexts, quite painful, and this is why, or painful for some people anyway, and this is why, in practical terms, it's always a very controversial policy and likely to face quite serious challenges. So my starting point is one really of methodology or definition, and if I might, I'll take issue with Jacob a bit just now, because in his remarks, introductory remarks, he did what is almost universally the case amongst economists and commentators, so he's not to blame for this, and that is to discuss trade as though it's something to do with nations. In other words, it's a question of which nations gain or maybe lose from a more open trade policy. And that's completely the wrong way to think about this. Methodologically and theoretically, that is simply not the way to understand what's going on here, because nations as such do not trade with each other. It is individuals who trade with each other, either as individuals or through some collective and cooperative enterprise which individuals collectively form, such as a company or a firm. So if you would go into the store and you buy a mobile phone which contains parts made in Taiwan or China, maybe assembled in the Philippines, you are indirectly trading with some individuals who live in those other parts of the world. It's not a case that this is a trade between some entity called Britain and another entity called Taiwan. These are actually aggregations, they're shorthand terms by which we describe the geographical and political social locations of the parties to the trade, but that's all they are. and it confuses and is deeply misleading to think of trade as actually occurring between some kind of hypothetical entity, some reified category called a country or something like that. Now, what follows from this, and this is the other vitally important point to grasp really as a foundational one, is that from the economist's point of view, it makes absolutely no difference whatever if the trade relationship in question involves a transaction that goes across a geopolitical border or not. From the economist's point of view, if you go and you buy a Cornish pasty, which of course thanks to the EU has to be made in Cornwall, you realise that, they are one of those protected geographical designations now, that is no different from buying a camcorder made in Japan. The only difference is that in one case the exchange has gone across a geopolitical border, that between the United Kingdom and Japan of course, and in the other case it has not, it's taken place within a geopolitical entity, the United Kingdom. But in economic terms, there's no difference between those two transactions. Maybe a big difference politically or in some other ways, but from the economist's point of view, there's no difference. Now, if you start to think that way, what you will realise is that in virtually every human society, other than the, actually I would argue, hypothetical case of a society made up of completely self-sufficient households, or a completely non-trace-based civilization such as that of the Inca Empire, there is always free trade. The issue is not free trade or protection. The issue is rather, what is the geographical area within which you have free trade? Because when you think about it, you have free trade within the United Kingdom. You have free trade within the territory of the United States. In fact, you could very well say that one of the defining features of a modern state, as opposed to, say, a feudal pre-modern state, is that there is free trade and exchange between the citizens who inhabit the territory of that state. As that remark indicates, this has not always been the case. Medieval France, for example, had a whole ton of internal tariff and control barriers between the various provinces and domains that collectively made up the estates of France, the French monarchy. England had an internal free market from a relatively early date, from the mid-17th century or even earlier, according to some historians. But so the question, therefore, is not what should we have free trade or not free trade? That comes from thinking too much of this in terms of politics. You should rather think about what is the geographical area within which free trade should take place. And that raises the obvious question. Is it the case that free trade will always be beneficial, no matter what? In which case, if that is so, then the optimum unit for free trade to take place within is the entire planet. Or is there some other factor which might lead you to think that free trade will only be beneficial if it takes place within an area that has certain qualities or characteristics in terms of maybe geographic endowments or the nature of the people who inhabit that area? Now, what is, to go back to real basics here, what is the principle of comparative advantage that David Ricardo famously adumbrated 200 years ago, almost exactly 200 years ago, in fact, in his treatise on political economy? It's important to realise, and this is one of the areas where I think the economists have not done a good job of educating the public, that comparative advantage has nothing to do with people having greater skill or greater natural endowments or greater resource endowments or tactical endowments than other people. That's all about absolute advantage. It has never been difficult to explain why it makes sense, for example, to import bananas from the West Indies rather than growing them in Scotland, and to make whiskey in Scotland rather than doing so in Barbados. That's an absolute advantage of natural geographical climate endowment between those two parts of the world. Comparative advantage is something else. And again, you can put the geographical model out of your head for the moment, actually, because comparative advantage is simply about the degree to which people have different skills and the degree to which the exercise of any one of those skills and endowments incurs an opportunity cost. The point is this: if you have, let's say, for example, for the sake of argument, that I am both a brilliant horticulturalist and a really good brain surgeon, the problem is that unless I'm in the world of Harry Potter and I have access to a time turner, I can't do both at once. If I am carrying out a brain surgical operation, I can't at the same time be cultivating my garden and doing the horticulture. Conversely, if I'm pruning my roses, I can't instead be using my hands to perform a brain surgery for the operation. Now, therefore, if I choose to be a brain surgeon, the cost of my doing this is the foregone alternative use of my talents and resources, in this case, is the horticulture. Conversely, if I concentrate on making roses, the cost of my doing so is the foregone brain surgery operation. Now, it may be that I have a neighbour, and I am a better brain surgeon than this neighbour. In fact, he can't even do that. But I'm also a much better gardener than he is. I can produce much better roses, I have real green thumbs and all the rest of the talents that gardeners are meant to have. But it still makes sense for me to specialise in being a brain surgeon and let him do my garden, because that the amount of time that frees up for me doing brain surgery is more value creating, more wealth creating, than if I were to spend some of my time digging roses in my garden. Now, when you think about comparative advantage in that way, what you realise is that this is actually just a principle of social cooperation. It's simply a principle of people doing, specialising in those things in which the opportunity cost for them is highest, so that they basically do the things they do relatively better compared to other people. What this also means, of course, is that you may be the most useless person on the planet. You are absolutely bottom of the skills table for everything, but there is still going to be something at which you have a comparative advantage. There will always be somebody who will be better off letting you do something for them so that they can concentrate on something else in which they're more productive. So thought of this way, free trade is simply a principle of social cooperation. What does it give rise to? Well, it obviously gives rise to a division of labour. Instead of this hypothetical me being both a brain surgeon and a gardener, I specialise in one thing, brain surgery, and I exchange the products of my brain surgery, the indirect products, the income I get, for the services of my next door neighbour who I pay to do the garden. Now, of course, it needn't be a next door neighbour. It could well be that I decide to exchange the products of my labour, standing up and talking like this, for example, for other things that maybe I could make, like beer, or wheat, or products from these agricultural growth products. But I find it's better, more sensible, for me to specialise in doing one thing and let somebody else specialise in producing the beer or the fancy pastries and the like. Now, put that way, it sounds really, really obvious and very, very simple that free trade must be good. Because according to this analysis, everybody is better off. In fact, that's almost a part of the definition of the trade relationship, that it's an exchange relationship by virtue of which both of the parties engaging in the trade relationship have their well-being improved. And who could possibly be against that? What problems could there possibly be? Now, it is true that in many cases the so-called gains from trade, which you can demonstrate through a quite simple mathematical exercise actually, do not accrue equally to the two parties in the exchange. It could well be that although both parties to the exchange are better off, one of them has captured more of the additional wealth that's created by the exchange than the other person does. This is due to whatever the terms of trade are, the rate at which the products of the two parties to the exchange for each other, and that's what determines that in that case. But even so, both people are better off. And most economists there say, look, that's the end of the argument. How could you possibly be against this, you fool? And so there are, you know, they get extremely irritated. So I have a friend called Don Boudreau, who is a professor of economics at George Mason University in Virginia. Don is the world's greatest writer of letters to the editor. He writes about four or five a day, seriously, no word of a lie. I know it's about four or five a day because four or five times a day I get an email from him, I'm on his email mailing list, in which he quotes the letter he's just written to the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal or the Washington Post or whatever it is. At the moment, pretty much every letter he writes, he's ranting and raving and fulminating, I don't think Don would mind my use of those terms, against Donald Trump. With each subsequent letter, I think Don's low, already incredibly low opinion of Donald Trump's knowledge and understanding of economics has plumbed new depths, basically. And Don is very typical of economists in this respect. He can't see, possibly, what the objection to this might be. So, What objection might there be if you do think of trade, as I've just described it, as being essentially the process by which social specialisation and social cooperation is produced by interchange between people regardless of geographical boundaries on the basis of their comparative advantage, which, as I say, is basically comparative opportunity costs. Well, it's worth thinking of an analogy here, which is to money. Money is a network good. One of the things about money is that the more people use a particular kind of money, the more valuable it is to the people who use it. If you had a kind of money, Cambridge pounds, that only circulated within Cambridgeshire, it would not be very useful to you, because it would mean that if you ever went to Norwich, not you want to, but if you ever did go to Norwich, you would find you'd have to exchange your Cambridge pounds for Norwich whatevers. This is burdensome and difficult. Conversely, if you have a kind of money which will be accepted all over the British Isles, it's much more valuable. So the basic principle of money, as I say, is it's a network good. The more widely people use it, the more useful it is to those people who use it. So the obvious question which was asked by economists in the 60s was, well, in that case, why do we not have global money? Why have we not got a single currency that everybody in the world uses? And Robert Mundell's answer to this question was it wasn't just the fact that rulers, for reasons of seniorage, the income you get from being the monopoly currency issuer, wanted to have local monopoly currencies. That is an undoubted factor. There's another reason, and this is that it only really pays to have a single money. It is only generally beneficial to the people using that single money in terms of increased opportunities for exchange if certain other conditions are met. The main one being that either you have a homogeneous business cycle in the area which is using the same money, or that does not apply, you have an integrated labour market, an integrated capital market, and crucially, some mechanism through the political process for redistributing income from parts of the area which are doing well to parts of the area which are not doing well, so that you have a way of dealing with exogenous shocks that have differential effects. And the euro, crucially, does not have that feature, which is why pretty much every economist on the planet thought that the euro was a bad idea and should not happen, and predicted pretty much exactly what has happened. The only thing that got wrong was they thought it would take 10 years and it actually took 5. Now, my argument is that actually, if you start to think more deeply about this, trade and trade exchange relations have some of the qualities of that. Viewed purely in the abstract, it seems that there's an overwhelming case for having a totally free trade world in which you are free to exchange goods and services with anybody anywhere else in the world. But actually, when you start to think about what that might lead to and how it would work out, you come to realise that actually it's much more tricky. And in particular, you come to realise that there's a connection between free exchange and division of labour within a given part of the planet's surface and political order, which also operates over that part of the planet's surface. So how might that be? Well, imagine you have a part of the world and within this part of the world, you have initially lots and lots of individuals, or more realistically, households, which are, in this hypothetical case, self-sufficient. As I say, that's a kind of hypothetical society which I doubt has actually existed, although some societies have come close to it. What you will find, of course, what people will find out through a discovery process, is that it does actually pay to specialise. So one household will discover that it pays to specialise in brewing beer and exchanging the beer they produce for corn grown by other households. And you'll then get lots and lots of bilateral exchange relations taking place within this area. Now, what defines the periphery of this area? What's the boundary of that area within which it actually makes sense to do this? Well, it's defined by a number of things. One of them is geography, another is technology. Crucially, the technology of communication and transportation. It doesn't make sense for somebody living over here, perhaps, to buy beer from somebody over here, simply because the cost of getting the beer there is too high, or by the time it gets there, it will have spoilt. But then if somebody builds a railway, then suddenly it becomes possible the geographical area within which it makes sense to have these exchanges will expand. At the same time, to add an additional level of complexity to this, what you find in the real world is that the geographical area within which naturally you will start to have free trade appearing, will be different for different kinds of products. So notoriously and classically, certain kinds of service, for example, haircuts, for instance, that sort of thing, massages, can only be traded over very, very short distances. Because unless you're a former president of the United States, you're not going to fly several thousand miles to have your hair cut. The opportunity cost is just way too high. So services typically are the geographical area within which there are mutual gains from the exchange. Is quite circumscribed. On the other hand, at the other extreme, luxury goods of certain kinds, goods which are compact, easy to transport and cheap to transport, but which have very, very high value to consumers, diamonds, for example, can typically be, or porcelain, historically, can be traded over extremely long distances. So what you will find, once the economy has gone past a certain point, come back to that in a moment, is that you will have quite complex interlayering of different natural communities of trade, if you will. Some will be for luxury goods, things like spices, historically, precious metals, valuable weaponry, that kind of thing, will be very, very large. They may indeed be global in scale, whereas others will be extremely local. It won't even coincide with the political territory of the state. You're not going to go all the way down to London, from Manchester or Ireland to have a haircut, for example. At least I wouldn't think so. It's not strange to do that. Now, what happens within this area when the trade takes place? Well, there are a number of... What happens is that a division of labour is created. People become more specialised, as I say. And you can trace historically how this process has gone on with the growth of trade and exchange amongst people in different parts of the world, different geographical locations. If you went back to the average household, say, in the 16th century, that average household would produce about 30 to 40% of what it consumed. They would all certainly produce their own bread if they lived in the countryside. They'd probably produce their own beer. They would probably produce some of the items of clothing that they wore. So, whereas in the modern household, they produce almost nothing of what they consume. We've gone way away from that. Now, what that means, therefore, is that as the division of labour expands, as it becomes more and more intensified, people become more and more interconnected with the others around them, other people in the world. But these connections are of an impersonal nature. They're mediated by Thomas Carlyle's famous cash nexus. They're not face-to-face contacts. And also, people become more and more specialised. Now, what that also means is they become more and more vulnerable. Vulnerable to what? Well, to fluctuations in things like the pattern of demand or the movement of prices within the economic system, or for that matter, natural disasters on the other side of the world, which may have an effect on them. The more complex the economic system within which you are integrated by the growth of trade, the more you are subject, your life and position are prone to be subject to forces over which you have no control, which you do not even know about, much less understand, because you're part of an enormously complex system. Moreover, there are limits to the payoffs that you get from complexity. This is the insight that I would take from an author who I think is coming back into vogue a bit at the moment. He's not an economist, he's an historian, a man called Joseph Tainter. Not that one. Tainter, back in the late 60s, wrote a book, a couple of papers, about the collapse of complex societies. What you can observe if you look at history is that complex societies with elaborate division of labour frequently collapse. They break down into a much simpler, less complex form of social organisation. This is because as the society becomes more complex, two things happen. One is that the payoff for complexity becomes less and less because it requires more and more effort to actually keep the complex relations going. And so there's actually less net benefit from entering into them. And the other is that it becomes fragile. It becomes highly susceptible to systemic failure for one reason or another. So that's the first of the major drawbacks that you get. And this is one of the reasons why, historically, you don't simply see the growth of trade following a course like that. It isn't just the case that there's more and more trade all the time. Actually, the pattern, if you were to plot things like the growth of trade relations, it looks much more over a period of time. It looks much more like this. There's a general upward trend, but there's lots of big peaks and troughs. So the Roman world is fairly economically integrated, the Mediterranean, but by the time we get to the 8th century, the degree of economic integration around the Mediterranean has collapsed back to even a lower level than it was before the Roman Empire was created. So that pattern happens quite repeatedly. And one of the reasons is that beyond a certain point, there are actually quite severe social costs and limited gains associated with the increasing specialization that's brought about by exchange. Furthermore, there's another problem, which is worth highlighting at this point. Suppose this geographical area within which you have a comprehensive division of labor brought about by trade expands, and you find that it incorporates lots and lots of other people who previously were off here in a separate like division of labor, if you will, with only maybe trade in luxury goods and that kind of thing. And it now expands to incorporate, let's say, manufacturers, something like that. Now, to the economists, this sounds completely unproblematic because everyone is better off. If you have free trade between, let's say, China and the European Union, for example, everyone, qua consumer, gains because the goods are being produced more efficiently, people are following their comparative advantage, therefore they're doing the thing where their contribution to aggregate welfare, in this case global economic welfare, is greatest, and therefore, consequently, by definition, you will say everyone is better off. But it's not the case that everyone is better off. There are significant social casualties from this. People, qua consumer, will be better off. Some producers, as producers, will be better off. But a significant number of producers, particularly in perhaps the older, more established part of the world, will be worse off because they will find that they no longer have the comparative advantage that they had before. And that means that in plain English, they've got to maybe change their way of earning a living. And now this is never very easy, and it's costly. And the costs are not simply the kind of straightforward economic costs of having to acquire new skills, engage in new education, maybe move to a different physical location, things of that sort. There's also the severe psychological costs, if you will, the psychological well-being costs, which are unmeasurable but nonetheless real, maybe substantial, of finding that expectations you had about how you would live and make your living have been dashed and disappointed. Or discovering that the world that you expected to continue on in broadly the same way that it had done before is going to suddenly undergo quite radical and dramatic change. Moreover, what effectively takes place is a redistribution of well-being and resources within the now enlarged area of division of labour and exchange. If you think about the concrete case for the moment of production taking place in China and consumption taking place in Europe and vice versa, and therefore, in some sense, Europe and China being part of a single division of labour, which is what is the case when you think about things like those smartphones that I'm sure you all have, then who are the major gainers? Well, consumers in both countries are major gainers, but the other major gainers are producers, workers, if you will, the people who make mobile phones in places like Taiwan. Now, what economic theory predicts, including this goes back to Ricardo, in fact, is that there will be a gradual equalization of incomes for the same kind of work within the area within which the trade or exchange takes place. What this means is that in the long term, medium term, wages for productive work, in this case, mobile phone assembly in China, will increase, but in the other part of the world, they will decline. Or they may in fact even vanish because there's no longer a comparative advantage for producing mobile phones, say here in Cambridge or something like that. So there are identifiable groups of winners and losers, if you will. And very often, typically, these are not in the same political jurisdiction. Now, why does that matter? Well, it matters because of the political good of social harmony and social order. Having lots of people who are disgruntled for both economic and psychological reasons is a recipe for trouble, basically. And we can see this in the United States. Lots and lots of seriously angry, disgruntled people in places like Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Michigan, and the like, who voted for Donald Trump in November. I should say, by the way, that I had money on Donald Trump to win the election 11-1. I put a bet on him in January of last year. Because my own thinking was that if he managed to get the Republican nomination, he was definitely going to win the general. And the reason why I thought he would do that was because it was quite clear to me that he had a strong political appeal to a particular demographic, and that particular demographic happened to be geographically concentrated in states that were crucial for getting a majority in the Electoral College. And my rough calculation was that his actual voting figures were being understated by the polls to the tune of about 3 to 4% in a number of states. Turned out I was pretty much on the money. The only exception was Wisconsin, where the polls understated him by about 7%, and Pennsylvania, where they only understated him by about 2%. But my point, to go back to my main point, is that therefore there's a political good, and this is where the analogy with money becomes interesting. In theory, you might say, no problem with having the euro. The problem is that because we don't have means to adjust to differential shocks through flows of tax and spending from one part of the eurozone to another, you end up with the kind of catastrophic situation you currently see in Greece, and plus lots of very angry Germans who feel they're being screwed over by their government to subsidise idle, shiftless Mediterranean types. And something similar happens when you have an integrated division of labour within a large part of the planet's surface. The operation of that division of labour, although it will ultimately make everyone better off, imposes severe disruption and short-term costs on people within that geographic area where the trade is taking place. Now, the way you prevent that from causing social discord is through essentially redistributive acts by the political order. The state essentially taxes the more successful people who've made the big gains on the exchange, and uses this to, if you like, ease the cost of transition for the people who've lost out on the exchange. The problem is that when you don't have a single political order, it's difficult to do this. Moreover, in practical terms, actually having trade and exchange within a large part of the planet's surface typically works much, much better when you have a single political order. Now, there's a reason for this. It may just be the mundane fact that the state will stamp out piracy and banditry. You can't very well have trade and exchange when there's guys on horses wearing black masks about to swoop down out of the hills. But also it's because the state can impose things which make trade much, much easier. Things like a uniform system of weights and measures, for example, or certain kinds of infrastructure and communications resources, or, most importantly, a uniform system of commercial law. Now, economists like to think that these things evolve spontaneously, although just taken as given, but actually they're not. They're political creations. And so, to the extent that you do have a system of free exchange over a relatively large geographical area, which is diverse in terms of the geographical endowments that its inhabitants have, and obviously, therefore, the skills endowments and capital endowments that they have, this typically is associated with the existence of a political rule over that area, which provides both the institutional support for that exchange and also, crucially as I've said, deals with the process by which the exchange process itself, particularly in the early phases of its expansion, causes widespread social disruption with lots of ungrateful winners and pissed off losers, basically. Now, that explains why, to wrap up, the process of globalisation, as we misleadingly call it, the process by which economic integration and free trade does expand geographically and sectorally, goes in spurts. Because it's one thing to have a growth of trade within a single political entity, like, let's say, the 19th century United States. It's quite different to have that happening when many of the new divisions of labour cross geopolitical borders. That's where there is a difference. In purely economic terms, there isn't. But in terms of what you might call managing or dealing with the second order cultural, social, political effects of that economic integration, that is necessary. And what happened at the end of the 19th century was that the free trade regime that the British had created during the middle part of the 19th century, which came under increasing challenge from both the Americans and the Germans as the century drew to its end, by the way, was also increasingly producing effects which caused serious political reactions in the growth of both socialist and nationalist parties in many countries at the end of the 19th century. But there wasn't any really easy way of dealing with this because A, there weren't at that point mechanisms by which the state could redistribute income, but also because there wasn't a supranational authority that could govern this. And this actually then had rather bad results, put it mildly. So that's why I think that although indeed the economists are right, that the process of free exchange between individuals is indeed beneficial, and is also quite simply best understood as being the process by which social cooperation and the development of a more diversified society in which people have more particular roles and are enabled to be more productive because they can concentrate on the aspect of their talent and endowment which they have greater comparative advantage. Although that's undoubtedly true and correct case, the reality is that the way this mechanism works out historically in the real world is one which brings with it a number of significant, what you might call, I suppose, transition costs, or ongoing transition costs, because part of the process of change, of course, is that it's constant. And so there are always going to be people who are upset because they're losing out from changes that this has brought in its train. And therefore, what you tend to find historically is that complete economic integration is very hard to sustain unless you have some kind of general system of governance, not necessarily single state, but a system of governance which covers the entire land area within which this system of economic integration takes place. And at the moment, we are not there, which is why I think the next decade or so is going to be seriously interesting in terms of the world economy and the world history. So at that point, I'll stop. See if there are any questions.
So if anyone has any questions, then feel free to ask them. Otherwise, I can ask quickly.
Yep.
You said that it's going to be difficult for anything but a sort of supranational body to appease people. How do you think that individual governments, though, what can they do to help those who are basically just pissed off at?
This is an interesting question, because if you think, I mean, I'm a historian by training, and so one of the things you conclude with your historian is that there is really nothing new under the sun. And so how can you do this? Well, there are a number of different ways of doing it. And you might call, one of them is empire. Okay? If you read the works of Emmanuel Wallerstein, a man with whom I disagree with a great deal, but who also has, I think, some insights, what tends to happen in Wallerstein's account of history is that if you have an integrated economy, an integrated trade and division of labour, typically this turns into an empire. One part of it establishes political rule over the rest of it, and you have a single system of government. So the Roman Republic succeeds in conquering and then ruling all of the lands around the Mediterranean, which were already part of a single system of trade and economic relations. And it then expands beyond that into places like Gaul and Britain. That's one solution. Another solution is the one that the British tried to create in the 19th century. And this is one where you don't have a single political order for the whole area, but what you do is have a system of rules, general principles, most notably the gold standard, balanced budgets, things of that sort, which all governments voluntarily adhere to. Trouble is that, on the evidence, that's rather fragile, because of course the trouble is that you've got a collective action problem there, because it might be in the interests of all political ruling groups, states if you will, to adhere to these rules, because ultimately they will be the benefit of all for them to do so. But in any given particular point in time, there's always going to be at least one state for whom their short-term interest is best served by breaking the rules or having other people observe them. It's a classic prisoner's dilemma, in other words. And the problem is then if you have certain states which start to break the rules in a systematic way, which is what Imperial Germany began to do from the 1890s onwards, then the whole system just collapses, which is what happened, of course. Since 1945, the United States has been at the centre of a third attempt to do this, which is the one created in GATT, and that is the creation of a series of bilateral agreements which seek to achieve an integration of economic activity and free trade, basically through harmonising the regulatory regimes of different parts of the world, by creating a single uniform system of governance, which still comes from individual national governments, but which happens to be the same everywhere. Now, the way this works is, for example, so if I take the TTIP, Transatlantic Trade Investment Partnership Treaty, which has pretty much collapsed now, the negotiations are dead set all that, I think. What that was about harmonizing the American regulatory system with that of the EU. So that essentially the regulations governing, for example, meat production would be the same on both sides of the Atlantic. Now, that makes it easier to have the integration because it means that all parties are operating on a level playing field, famous expression. That's different to the 19th century British form, because it doesn't depend upon a series of general rules governing the conduct of states. It requires detailed harmonisation of regulatory regimes. It appears, I think, that model is also past its salvo date, partly because of abuse of it by the United States. Very severe abuse, in my view, in recent years, particularly in the regime of area of intellectual property. One of the reasons why I personally was against TTIP was because it became clear to me that it was basically just a scam by which the United States was looking to extend its global, its intellectual property regime even more widely than it's already applied. What might we do in the future? Well, another possibility is to allow for the process of a spontaneous bottom-up evolution of rules and institutions that govern trade over very, very large and diverse geographical areas. This has again happened before. In the medieval world, you have extensive trade relations all over Eurasia which are not governed by rules or regulations created by any single prince or ruler or kingdom. They emerge spontaneously out of the interactions between people involved in trade, buyers and sellers. The problem with that is it doesn't allow for adjustments for the disruptive effects, which I mentioned. That does typically seem to require action by sovereign states. It's hard to see how else it could be done.
Any other questions?
Given your greatly successful prediction with Trump, I wonder what you think will happen with the EU. Do you think that will disintegrate as these populist nationalist movements rise up, or will it become this more integrated state?
That's a very good question. The EU is, the honest answer is, good Lord, who knows? The EU is on a bit of a cusp at the moment, it's fair to say. At one extreme, if Marine Le Pen wins the election in May, I don't think she will, but I think she's going to be a lot closer than most people think, then that's the end of the EU. She has said that she will immediately withdraw France from the Euro and that she will have a referendum on France's withdrawal from the EU. And all the indications from various surveys are that the French would vote heavily to leave, much more heavily than the British did. And that's the end of the EU, basically. Unlikely she will. I think Macron is more likely to be her opponent in the second round, and she will probably lose to him quite handsomely. I think she'd probably lose by about 60 to 40, maybe 55 to 45, that kind of margin. I do think she's going to win in 7 years' time, though, by the way. So I think that's her strategy as well. Her strategy is not to beat somebody this time around. Her real strategy this time around is to humiliate and destroy the centre right. So that in 7 years' time, it's a choice between her and somebody from the left. She would probably win that, and I think she's correct in that calculation. On the other hand, on the other extreme, it does look on the current German polls as though Angela Merkel's time as German Chancellor is about to come to an end. And it looks like the Social Democrat candidate for Chancellor Schulz is going to become the next Chancellor, probably at the head of a red-green coalition of the SPD, Die Linke, and the Greens. He's a feminist. So if that happens, there will be a significant push for greater integration, a full fiscal, monetary, banking union, and the creation of something like a European government with tax and spending powers, which is what the Eurozone will have if it's to survive in the medium to longer term. They won't make a move towards that, though, before the German election, because if there were proposals for this before the election in September, that would lead to a significant boost in support for AfD, the Alternative for Deutschland Party, which currently is polling about 15%, but I think would go up to about 25% in that case. So it'll happen at the end of next year. Personally, I'm sceptical. I think they will have a real go at creating a single union, but I think the political opposition to this is just too strong, particularly in Germany, but also in other parts of Europe as well. And I therefore am rather bearish on the EU's future in the medium term. It's always dangerous to count the EU out because it has this amazing ability to stagger on, but I do think it's quite likely that it will not be around in 10 years' time, which is actually not good news, because although I was a Leave voter, it's not in anybody's interest to have a disorderly collapse of the EU or of the Eurozone. Either of those would be a geopolitical and economic catastrophe, actually. The problem is that we've got this horrendous mistake that was made at Maastricht, and it's a question of how do you unpick it, basically.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you, you said that economic integration and free trade generally work within the same political jurisdiction, because then you would be able to redistribute towards people who lose out. But do you not think that this idea of redistribution actually is not very compatible with the model of free trade in the first place? Because what you see, for example, in the United States is that income inequality is getting greater and greater the more they move toward sort of free market model.
That doesn't necessarily, the fact that it might lead under certain circumstances to greater income inequality, I'll come on to why that might be in a moment, does not necessarily mean that therefore you can't address that by having a redistributive tax and transfer system. On the contrary, you could well argue that's in fact what makes the political need for that all the greater. Personally, my view is if everyone is getting substantially better off, then it doesn't really matter if some people are getting really, really better off. The problem in the United States elsewhere is that there's a significant number of people who are not that much better off at all. Their incomes in real terms have remained stagnant for quite a long time now. They are still slightly better off because of what's called hedonic benefits, the fact that products are cheaper. So you can buy all kinds of stuff. If your income in real terms is no higher than it was in 1970, you could still buy a load of stuff that was not around in 1970. And those dollars go quite a bit further. But even allowing for that, it is true that living standards for a large population have stagnated. That's the problem. Now, why might you find that freer trade and economic integration leads to a significant increase in inequality? It doesn't have to, but it can do. The way in which it can do is if it opens up markets and trade in certain kinds of human services. Free trade in goods and agricultural products and things of that sort does not generally lead to an increase in income inequality. But free trade in things like sporting talent or musical talent does, or indeed talent in areas like, say, the law or medicine or managerial ability. That's because markets in what you might call human capital endowments, which is what we're talking about here, have a very pronounced winner-takes-all distribution, and this is an inevitable feature of those markets. Now, when the market for, let's say, top-flight footballers is basically limited to individual national leagues, the amount of money that any one footballer can get is limited by that fact. What you now have is footballers operating in an increasingly global market, which, as we now know, has come to include China. And what this means is, given that there's a limited number of the really special footballers who make a big difference, is that their value is bid up, and you get this very pronounced winner-takes-all effect, where most footballers actually don't make any money from the trade. There's a very small minority who actually make a living from it, and within that small minority, there's an even smaller minority who are, you know, incredibly, in my view, overpaid. People like Wayne Rooney, who make £300,000 a week. £300 a week, there you go. I'm a City fan, by the way, so I would say that. That's why it can happen. It's not free trade per se that can lead to a real stretching of the income differential. It's trade in certain areas, and what we've seen in this last 30, 40 years is a huge expansion of trade, and free globalisation of trade, to include what are basically human capital trades, things like the markets in entertainment or something of that sort. And those are all markets with very, very pronounced winner-take-all income distributions. And inevitably, that means very high levels of inequality. Not a lot you can do about that to prevent it happening. If you do want to do something about it, you almost certainly have to use the tax system to do something about it. The kind of ideas that Jeremy Corbyn came up with, like, oh, let's have maximum wage limit, that's just insane, quite frankly, ludicrous. The fact that Danny Blanchflower and Richard Murphy, who, neither of whom could be described as remotely favourable to the free market side, because both thought this was an insane idea, tells you what it is. If you do want to deal with that, the thing to do is to have much higher taxes on higher income, precisely. And redistribute.
Yeah, that's actually precisely what I was asking. Can we trust the political establishment to tax those who win from free trade and redistribute? And if we can, is that even going to be palatable to the people who politically support free trade?
Honestly, it could be. There's no necessary connection between being a supporter of free trade and having a particular view about equality of incomes. Quite a lot of famous economists who are strongly supportive of free trade have been also economic egalitarians. Those are two separate issues, really. You can disassociate them. The other question you raise, that's a function, really, of the incentives facing the politicians. who do they think is most important for them to suck up to be blunt about it, really. And I think what's beginning to dawn on a lot of the political class at the moment is there's a lot of angry people up there. It was a big sort of like opportunity for them to appeal to them. The problem we've had in, and I say this quite frankly, in the last 30 to 40 years in Western political systems, is that politicians cannot communicate with the public except through television. And television is very, very expensive. And so what that means is that they become very dependent on large donors. Political participation has become very, very restricted, meaningful political participation, because politicians find it very hard to communicate with the public in the way that they used to, things like speeches, mass meetings, canvassing, all those kind of things. They have to use television, and that means you need to have lots and lots of money, which means that the people who invest in politics come to have a disproportionate say in it. But I think that's actually going to reverse. I mean, one of the things about Donald Trump, which has not attracted anywhere near as much attention as it should have done, is that he managed to win the election in the United States without spending anything like as much money as his opponent. He spent a fraction of what Hillary Clinton did, but he got a much bigger payoff because I think Trump has discovered there are new ways of communicating with the public that don't require lashing out absolutely tons of money. And I think we're actually at the start of a different political cycle, so I think we're going to see a shift in the incentives facing members of the political class. Now, I might not like all the things that results in, but I do think we're seeing a different, you know, framework for their actions. Politicians will always do what is most likely to get them elected.
I'd like to ask, I think it's going to have to be our last question actually, unless someone has a really pressing question they'd like to ask. Okay, so essentially, it seems like we've focused an awful lot on basically developed economies, and a lot of your arguments to do with these integrating regions seem to be loosely divided into two kinds of regions. One with a lot of absolute advantage, so developed economies, and one with relatively less. And then it seems that as they expand, many of those within the absolute advantage region find that as comparative advantage changes, some of them lose out heavily. And then provided there's enough redistribution within the political system, this can be assuaged, is essentially your argument.
Yes.
So my question is then on the other area. It's on the area which then may open up and use its comparative advantage, the essentially lesser developed economies. And it basically comes right around to something you said earlier, which was how was this political integration managed to sort of assuage the political resistance. And the one which you came up with historically is empire. I would agree that empire is being almost universally the means by which sufficient political coherence and cohesion has been achieved. Evidently, we don't want to move back to that. And so my question is that, given that many of these economies will question the fact that if they were concede to their comparative advantage today, they essentially consign themselves to, in the long run, less productive, less high-income industries. For example, if you were going to divide up the entire world, someone has to make the food. Very few countries would want to be agriculture exporter because it is ultimately a lower income lifestyle.
Not necessarily. Well, there are several things like that. One of them is actually, in my own view, as you know, is that in the next 20 years we're going to get rid of agriculture and produce farms with different food in a different way. But leave that to one side for the moment. Assume that isn't going to happen. It is not necessarily the case that you are going to be in a low-income economy if you're a primary products producer. Denmark, for example, is a country which becomes extremely rich through intensive agriculture. Similarly, Australia, New Zealand, Uruguay, these are all countries which achieve developed status, have high per capita, GNP per capita, high income per capita, through specialising in agricultural production. So that doesn't necessarily follow. In addition to that, you have to remember, of course, that the whole economy and the nature of the economic relations that are produced by more free exchange and trade are dynamic, and that therefore, just because at a given point in time a particular part of the world is, for example, the site of low-cost manufacturing because of lower labour costs and things of that sort, therefore less opportunity costs for engaging that kind of thing, doesn't mean that it's going to stay that way. In fact, what Ricardo's own theory tells us is that that will not remain the case. That typically the comparative advantage will change over time. We can see this happening where the Chinese economy, for example, to be more accurate, the parts of the world economy located in the part of the world we commonly call China, are moving out of low-cost, low-wage-cost manufacturing and increasingly into other areas. And it's places like Vietnam, which are now moving into the area of manufacturing. So if you're thinking about this in terms of development economics, then there's actually a much stronger case for expanding free trade for developing countries than it is for rich ones. because they are much more likely to find some activity within which they will get significantly more net income wealth created than they have done before. You should not think that the kind of thing they turn out to have a comparative advantage in at point A in time is the same one that they will have at point A plus 40 years or A plus 20 years. In fact, it would be very surprising if it were. There would have to be some really significant natural endowment to explain why that would be the case. You would normally expect that there would be significant changes in their comparative advantage. And finally, as I say, it's not the case that primary product production can be very low income if you've got low value added to the bottom of the supply chain, basically. But not necessarily. And there are other ways around that, basically. So one thing I didn't mention, by the way, before I have to dash off, I'm afraid, to come back to the station, is migration. Because one of the other adjustment mechanisms which operates historically is movement of people, of course. And David Ricardo, in his famous case, where he does it in terms of countries, which is his big problem, Portugal and England, two products, wine and cloth, he assumes, explicitly assumes, that capital is not mobile, which is a major flaw in his analysis, in my view. In fact, it actually works better if capital is mobile. But what he also doesn't discuss, because it didn't even occur to him, is mobility of labour. And one of the things that happens within a large part of the planet's surface, which has an integrated trade system, is significant movement of labour. In fact, you can argue that that's an essential part of the whole process. It's not going to be able to work properly if that's not the case. Because someone who has a comparative advantage in, let's say, that hypothetical brain surgeon I was talking about, if he's living in Shetland, that comparative advantage of being a brain surgeon is not actually realised, because the scope for exercising brain surgery in Berwick is pretty limited. But if he moves to London, his comparative advantage is then realised and enormously enhanced, because he's in a part of the world where lots of opportunities to be a brain surgeon. Now, therefore, maximising the comparative advantage and making the exchange system produce the greatest net benefits for the greatest number of people probably involves as much free movement as possible. Now, put my own cards on the table before I leave you. I'm an open borders person myself, and I think the evidence is pretty clear. If you had open borders, all the models that have been done indicate that this would increase world GDP by well over 100%. So it would double total world wealth per capita. There might be lots of other problems, however, which is why, of course, this is not going to happen. One of the benefits why it's not going to happen. But you do need to have free movement, I think. And free movement to people within the area, which has the economic integration, is one of both a safety valve, but also it's an essential part of the whole process. And this is another one of the reasons why, typically, historically, expansion of the division of labour and trade runs into serious political barriers, because people do not like the change that is represented by lots of people who are not like themselves moving in next door to them or near to them. This is a sad fact of human nature, I'm afraid. Typically, once they've had somebody new living next to them for a while, they're perfectly relaxed about it. But initially, they're not. In fact, when they're really worried is when somebody new moves in 5 or 6 streets away from where they live. All the polls indicate that hostility to people of a different ethnicity or religion or racial group is most strong amongst people who actually do not have anybody like that living near them, but who know that somewhere down the road, maybe 100 miles away, there are lots of people like that. That's the typical pattern. So unfortunately, that's part of the political dynamic that you have to deal with when you get racial economic integration. Migration gives rise to, as part of the process, typically stirs up a rather unpleasant backlash, which is what we're seeing at the moment.
Well, thanks very much. That was a really interesting talk. So,
right, thanks so much.